name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In our gospel reading for today, we have four main characters: Mary Magdalene, the unnamed beloved disciple, Peter, and Jesus. Mary is the first who we encounter. She was the first to go to the tomb, presumably to anoint the body. When she arrived, she found that the stone, which was really more like a boulder, was rolled away. She didn't investigate further. She didn't look inside the tomb. She immediately ran and told Peter and the beloved disciple what she had seen. She assumed that the body had been moved or stolen. The beloved disciple, who doesn't have a name, was the next to approach the tomb. He and Peter raced to get there. He got there first and peered in, but Peter shoved past him, because that's kind of how Peter was. And it was only after Peter went in that the beloved disciple entered the tomb. And once in the tomb, he saw the linen wrappings, the things that Jesus had been buried in, just laying there. And that was when he saw and believed. But then the text says that he didn't understand the scripture that Jesus must rise from the dead. That's a little confusing, but I'll come back to that. The last person to arrive to the tomb, but the first person to go in, it's a little confusing, was Peter. And while he was the last, he was the first, because he was always a little impulsive. Think first, act first, think later. The Gospel of John doesn't tell us what Peter actually thought, but another gospel tells us that Peter was amazed. Both he and the beloved disciple left as soon as they'd seen the tomb. But Mary, who had come back, stayed and wept. Each of these disciples of Jesus had very different reactions to the empty tomb. Peter was amazed, which means he was in a state of wonder. The response of the beloved disciple is somewhat mysterious, and that it says that he saw and believed, but it also says that he did not yet understand the scriptures about Jesus being raised from the dead. So we know what he saw, but what did he believe? I'm not sure it really matters. The point is that he believed in something. The empty tomb gave him just enough faith to believe in something. And then there was Mary. We have the most information about her reaction. The first time she saw the empty tomb, she ran away, terrified. But she came back, and this time she stayed. She stayed, and she wept. One can only imagine how much she had already wept. She had stood at the foot of the cross while Jesus slowly died. I imagine on this day that she might have been hoping for some closure to her grief, and what she found was a gaping hole, not closure. And out of nowhere appeared two angels. Mary didn't recognize them as angels. Had she realized who they were, she might have figured it all out a little more quickly. Instead, she told them that they had taken away her Lord and Savior, and she didn't know where to find him. And then Jesus appeared and asked why she was weeping. But she didn't recognize him either. Only when her name was spoken by Jesus did she finally realize that not only was her Lord alive, but he was standing right next to her. Each of these disciples reacted to the tomb in different ways, but it would be a stretch to say that the empty tomb allowed them to believe in the resurrection. At worst, it terrified them, and at best, it gave them something to ponder. It was only when they saw Jesus in the flesh did they truly believe. Yet today, I stand before you asking you to believe something based on a story that was told 2,000 years ago, and I don't even have an empty tomb. This story goes against everything that we know and believe about how the world works, how our human bodies work. Each disciple's faith journey was different. They met Jesus in different places, quite literally. And Jesus approached them in different ways. The beloved disciple believed something, but he couldn't really understand it. Mary only believed when she'd heard her name. And it would seem that the beloved disciple and Peter only truly understood the resurrection when Jesus made a dramatic entrance to the room that they were hiding in. Much like the earliest disciples, we all experience faith in different ways. Some of us don't need a lot of convincing. We heard the stories growing up and they just stuck. Some of us don't fully understand it, but we still believe. We're not sure what we believe, but we believe something, and that leaves us wanting more. Some of us are content in the mystery and wonder of it all. But then there are many of us who look in that empty tomb and say, "Where is Jesus? Where did my Lord and Savior go when I needed him the most?" And that is something that Mary can teach us. She teaches us to rest in our fear, in our doubt, in our grief. The other disciples left. They figured, well, there's nothing else to see here. But Mary stayed and she wept until Jesus called her by name. And I cannot help but wonder why Jesus came to Mary first. I mean, why not the beloved disciple? He must have been special if that was his name. Or Peter, on whom Jesus would build his church. Why did he appear to the person who seemed the most confused, the slowest to understand? Because she stayed. She stayed at the foot of the cross when he was crucified. She stayed at the empty tomb when she was afraid and confused and a little angry. She stayed. Now, sometimes we confuse faith with magic. We think it should be effortless and immediate. We imagine it comes in visions and transcendent experiences. And for some people, that might be true. But for most of the people who I've talked to, a lot of them clergy, faith is a struggle. It is a long walk full of confusion and clarity, doubt and assurance, grief and joy, and it's all muddled together. Now, that might not be what you want to hear on Easter. Easter should be about joy and candy. And while it is more complicated than that, there is joy and love and transcendence on Easter. Because at the end of Mary's journey, back and forth to the cross, back and forth to the grave, she was able to proclaim to the disciples who had already left, "I have seen the Lord." And that is the most that any of us can ask for, a moment when we can say with assurance that we have encountered the living God. So consider the times when you have encountered God or the divine. It doesn't have to be majestic. It might be very simple. When have you felt close to God? Is it yoga? The birth of a child? The baptism of a child? The first time you felt love? The holy moment when you held the hand of a loved one as they slipped from this life to the next? A harvest moon that took you by surprise? A rainbow you saw because you were stuck in traffic on the Hampton Roads bridge tunnel? Think about it. Those moments are precious and holy. But what makes those moments faith-sustaining is the ability to put them in the context of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. And that is why we meet in church every Sunday to talk about these things. Of course you can experience God outside of church. You absolutely should. But here's where we make the connections between the ordinary and the extraordinary, and to one another who are all experiencing these troubled times, these joyful times, because sometimes it's not all about joy and candy. Sometimes it's cold and rainy on Easter. So we come together to remind ourselves and one another of these holy moments, to help one another see more clearly. And then we can say together, I have seen the Lord. So if you have thought of that moment when you have experienced God, and I want you to say it with me. Ready? I have seen the Lord. Well, you said it, so I suspect you meant it, but let us now say it like we mean it. Are you ready? I have seen the Lord. Hallelujah. Again, yeah, very good, Mom. Now, we have a unique moment today. Baptisms are a wonderful experience of the holy, and so I want to welcome you all. Let us continue.